the Kenise Lyons, entitled Shipwrecks, The Middle Passage, and Finding the Way Back Home, A Black American Woman's Journey to, Through, and From Italian Studies.
I graduated in 2012, had a very traumatic experience, and have remained silent for a very long time, and I would appreciate some patience so that I'm able to actually have my say. So, when I first wrote my abstract, I intended to talk about how, when I first began my doctoral studies, I felt like Dante's Navicella at the beginning of Purgatorio. And by the end, I had more in common with Padre Antoni's boat in I Malevoglia. While the first little boat was eager to sail the better waters of the mind on the way to paradise, the latter was torn apart and sunk as a result of transgressing the, quote, natural laws of social order as it relates to class. Like the Sicilian patriarch, I had the audacity to move beyond society's place constructed for me and go my own way, and for that was destroyed, shipwrecked like Dante's Ulysses. I wanted also to say how now I do not see myself as being destroyed by my efforts to define life on my own terms, but rather given the opportunity to more fully disembark from the ship of white supremacy, like many of my ancestors during the Middle Passage who chose to jump into the Atlantic rather than live in slavery. Like them, I did not die, but by leaving the field, was actually born anew and able to find my way back home, not to who I was, but to who I was actually intended to always be, without all of the conditioning. My remarks today are quite different, still personal, yet not so scholarly. In other words, rather than intellectualizing my experience, I wanted to make it a tangible idea. I wanted to make it tangible. It is an experience that is not only and forever mine, and I say this to kind of put the, I'm not the spokesperson for all black folk in the field, nor should my I intend for my words to be used as fodder for resolving a problem. I'm just giving a behind the scenes glimpse at what it's like to be not only in an Italian class, but trying to have made a way in the field of Italian. My remarks also fill what I see as a gap in recognizing the historical, philosophical, and ideological causes for the paucity of intersectionally diverse students in Italian studies. There is a reason why we are not here in high numbers, or do not stay. And it has less to do with the intersectionally diverse, or the present day, and much more to do what Charles W. Mills, a University of Toronto-trained philosopher here at CUNY, calls the racial contracts, or if you want to take out racial, put ability, gender, sexuality, class, whichever, that have been elaborated both here and in Italy over the course of the 16th century. And here I'm thinking specifically about Leo Africanus' 9-volume Descrizione dell'Africa, consolidated in the 19th and 20th centuries in both places, and in Italy specifically through the texts of Cesare Lombroso, such as Criminal Man and Criminal Woman, and in the fascist era with texts like La Faccetta Nera, which I want you to hold on to. These contracts tacitly remain today due to our often unconscious resistance or downright refusal to recognize, confront, and rewrite them. But as Dr. Phil says, you can't change what you cannot confront. And to also quote my grandmother, Willie B. Sadler, tell the truth and shame the devil. My remarks today may be hard to hear because of the deeply conditioned and entrenched forms of responses that Robin DiAngelo, an Italian-American, calls white fragility. That comes when people who do not see themselves as racialized are, one, encouraged to listen to the ways that racialized peoples experience their racialized existence, and two, have their beliefs and assumptions about race identified and challenged. And again, racialized could be changed with any social category. But I'm specifically talking about gender and race. I'm going to encourage you to recognize your responses and sit with this, the discomfort as it arises, and Lord knows I am, and not let cognitive dissonance take over. I say these words to create a the brave space I need to fearlessly self-express, and we need in order to enter into truly productive dialogue. Okay, so let's start. At the beginning of my doctoral studies, I was told by a trusted professor that language would be my Achilles heel. It was a prophetic word spoken by a man whose opinion I trusted more than my own at that juncture. And through the magic of those two powerful psychological forces of the human mind, confirmation bias and stereotype threat, made into my very own reality. Whether it concerned my writing style, the use of the wrong preposition when speaking in a language that was not yet my own, using terminology associated with ideas that did not fit within other people's worldview, or the length of time I needed to process other people's words and produce my own. It felt to me as if every aspect of my communicative abilities were under fire, no matter how much I self-censored. And boy, did I. I watched every word and the thought they embodied that I said, for fear that it would be found unacceptable to the ears of those who held, or at least I thought at the time, my professional and academic future in their hands. Well, inevitably, these words were always found wanting, and not just because they did not measure up to someone else's standards. My words were found wanting because they were not my own. They were a poor reflection of who I thought I had to be, not just in order to fit in, be seen, and understood, but inevitably to be enough. There were so many ways that I was made to feel throughout my doctoral studies in Italian and subsequent efforts to make a career, whether intentionally or not, that I was not enough and therefore did not belong. The practices of exclusion I experienced included both macro and microaggressions that, in my opinion, served to remind me of having transgressed the bounds of social expectations and to manipulate, contain, constrain, neutralize, and transform my, quote, unforgivable blackness into a more palatable form. I open up this parenthesis here to say, let us be clear, this is not just an issue for Italian studies. It's an issue in higher education and societies, both American and Italian, at large. So in parentheses. Language, whether in the form of the policing of my knowledge, use of morphology and syntax, the curtailing of my word choice, So language at a time when America was, quote, in a post-racial phase, which I always knew to be mythical and downright delusional, was the least overt and most covert means through which my blackness could be contained. By the time I submitted the first draft of my dissertation, which explored post-war Italian cinema's interplay and remediation of photography and photographic discourse, which was actually metaphorical because I really most likely just wanted to work on black people and in Italy, but chose not to for very strategic reasons related to what I saw in a woman who graduated from Brown in 2004. She had no career. And so I erroneously thought doing something different would save me, and it didn't. So close the parenthesis again. So by the time I submitted my first draft of my dissertation, my ability to communicate my thoughts, even in my first language, was so distorted, and the words I expressed so contorted that I was told to get checked out for a learning disability. If it was not for the patience of one dear woman sitting in this audience right now, Millicent Marcus, and her lovely husband, who actually edited my dissertation, I would have never completed, submitted, or successfully defended the dissertation or graduated and become the first African-American first African-American to earn a PhD in my department in the history of Yale. I will be eternally grateful to her and to another woman who always recognized and believed in the beauty of my ideas, Stefania Lucamante. Both women have always supported me and firmly advocated for my inclusion in the professoriate along with Marianne Carolyn. But alas, it was not enough. I was unable to make inroads into the career in Italian studies, and not just because the job market is so dismal. It was also because of the some questionable practices that are actually unethical and illegal, that make it hard for me as a non-native speaker, a non-Italian candidate, let alone Black American, Southern cis woman from the middling class. Hey, I always believe identity is intersectional. And a woman whose body and worldview problematizes the neat categories of social identity, racial contracts, and the practices of exclusion that they undergird. I will pause here again to quote D'Angelo when she says, exclusion by those at the table doesn't depend on willful intent. We do not have to intend to exclude for the result of our actions to be exclusionary. Now, there's nothing wrong with being white and proud of your culture. Yet, I will say, as Stephen King reminds us, or Steve King, our lovely congressman from Iowa, there is everything wrong with being white supremacist, which I understand is when race privilege meets power. And as a recovering supremacist myself, hey, it's about ideology and not skin color. I understood firsthand the ways that you can discriminate against non-whites regardless of your intention. So I had to sit with and discover the hidden racial contracts that shaped my experience in both Italy and America and actively process each point so that I could heal my trauma and release the bitterness I felt as a result of my experiences as an emerging Italianist. It was also integral with surrendering my fight to join the professoriate and galvanizing my efforts to create diverse, inclusive, and equitable societies in which all people can, and not just the right kind of people, can be well. The most salient aspect of my detaching from the psychological, emotional, and racialized trauma that I will close with is the reality of discovering that, after all, language was not my Achilles heel. In actuality, it was not recognizing the value of my voice. There were so many things I wanted to, could have, and should have said to shape my experience as a graduate student. My belief that my silence would save me from the fate of the only other black person I knew who had graduated with a PhD in Italian from Brown in 2004, caused me to let so many things go unsaid. I wish I could have told my professor not to call me the Black Pearl, tokenism at its worst. Called out a colleague who told me that Black people have nothing to do with Italy. Another one who said that they were marveled at my strength as they could never be in this field and be Black. And again, yet another who, when I described myself as Black, told me that I was not really Black. Like, what does that mean? And of course, that's rhetorical because I know what it means. And I don't wish to answer it, think about the answer even though I know what it is. I wish I could have told my cohort that they're excluding me from study groups and community building opportunities over pizza was more about their patriarchy than my racialized gender difference. I wish I could have told ethnic white guards at the Sterling Library who refused my entry that even if you don't think I deserve to be, I'm supposed to be here, so let me in. I wish that I could have told people who thought my intersectionality always and forever cut me off from knowledge about Italy, and as a result, my contributions did not matter, how wrong they were. I wish I could have said to the people who balked at my frustrations about my employability in the field as a Black woman, and I'm almost done, look, I don't want to pass because I'm Black. I just don't want to be passed over because I'm Black. It's the latter that's the problem. I wish I could have more loudly advocated for and actively grown departmental and disciplinary structures for intersectionally diverse graduate students, which is what I actually did on the rest of Yale's campus as a diversity fellow. That went beyond access and success to build capacity for diversity, because that's actually the point. Chief among these would be climate and professional vitality and viability for students of color. Now that I know better, I can do and am doing better, actively creating diverse, inclusive, and equitable climates and cultures in which all can develop and feel empowered to make their own unique contributions to organizations, communities, disciplines, whatever, of their choice. Most importantly, here today, I am finally having my say, and for that, I am most appreciative.
John Champagne, Italian Studies, Queer Possibilities.
Thank you. As a proud graduate of Hunter College and a former student of both the late Louise DeSalvo and Audre Lorde, I am really honored to be here speaking to all of you today. Reading the temperature of a discipline is always a fraught process, as one's perspective is typically relative to where one stands. It is easy to wrongly assume that one's local position is symptomatic of more global trends, particularly given the different kinds of working conditions we face. This is in part what makes an event like ours so important, as we have this opportunity to provide one another with reports from the field. Additionally, recent critics of what is called chromonormativity have argued for an attentiveness to difference in temporal rhythms. We sometimes forget, for example, that the pace with which a discipline can accommodate new kinds of scholarship and localized alternative classroom pedagogies is often quicker than that at which it welcomes substantive curricular reform, new faculty lines, and productive challenges provided by new faculty and scholars, and their hopefully iconoclastic ideas. One of the many potential hazards of the precariousness of faculty positions in languages today is a chilling of the atmosphere for innovation. As someone who began his career in what is now called queer studies, someone whose PhD is actually in English and who has a tenured position, my perspective on diversity in Italian studies is unique. That I am here today contributing to this conversation is some evidence of Italian studies' queer possibilities. Had it not been for the openness in some quarters of Italian studies to interdisciplinary work, you would not be hearing these words, at least not from this particular mouth. I have been fortunate that, despite that my Italian remains and will remain sempre un lavoro in corso, editors have been willing to publish my scholarship, and some colleagues open to reading it, and at least one journal trusts me to review for publication papers on gender, sexuality, Italy, if you can't figure out which journal that was. That my entree into Italian studies occurred as a result of a disciplinary interest in interdisciplinarity may suggest that it was the interdisciplinary nature of my scholarship and not its queerness that got me in the door in the first place. But perhaps it was not one or the other, but both. I understand that in the face of institutional pressures to fill classroom seats, interdisciplinarity risks diluting the value of rigorous work in the Italian language in favor of English language culture courses that deal with Italy. But some excellent recent work in Italian in queer studies reminds us that the either-or proposition, either monodisciplinary work in Italian or interdisciplinary work in English, is a false one. English language work in Italian queer studies promises to rewrite the history of so-called Euro-American modern sexuality, in particular decentering the US, for example, as point of origin of modern queer culture. In other words, queer studies needs Italian queer studies. What we still lack that I feel we most need are institutionalized structures to foster collaboration between faculty. Faculty from different institutions, faculty from different disciplines, faculty whose differing historical experiences of global inequality have shaped their understanding of what it means to work in Italian studies, and even faculty with different abilities in Italian. While there might be something emotionally and intellectually thrilling about warding off the Huns at the gate, ultimately this kind of disciplinary policing does not respond to the complex global networks of which our lives today are composed. People today live and speak a variety of kinds of Italian. While not a teacher of the Italian language, I regularly teach English composition, the subfield that historically has perhaps most responded to the need to reimagine English as a discipline, thanks to CUNY professor Mina Shaughnessy. The opening up of the American University to second and third language learners made us aware of both the way structuralism's synchronic focus on langue rather than parole failed to capture the dynamism of language as it is actually lived, and that the concept of fluency is a relative one and hardly ideologically neutral. If we were to understand Italian today as a global language, how might Italian studies be reconfigured? But interdisciplinary work requires institutional structures of support, and one that I have relied upon is the AAIS's Queer Caucus. The caucus literally provided me a point of entry into Italian studies and a space where I felt welcome. Note that this caucus was and remains a self-sustaining effort. I hope I do not sound too defensive when I say that the caucus exists because a group of precarious queers, young graduate students, did the necessary labor to bring it into being. In other words, AAIS did not invite the caucus in, the caucus elbowed its way through the door. It remains largely underused by members who do not self-identify as queer. Its position is precarious. To return to this issue of different disciplinary rhythms, in my own field today of English studies, no one can get away with simply closing his, her, their eyes in the hope that queer studies goes away. My sense is that in Italian studies, it is still possible to conduct one's intellectual life minus even a bit of disciplinary guilt at one's ignorance of Italian queer work. That is, those different disciplinary rhythms should not blind us to the fact that queer Italian studies is still to some degree marginalized. In other words, people see a blip in publication, right, and think, oh, happy days are here, when in fact that can be deceiving. To return to the caucus, following last year's meeting in Sorrento, AAIS members received a letter regarding the creation of a diversity and inclusion committee, which is a great thing. No members of the caucus, however, were invited to participate, and no one came to any of our roundtables to introduce the idea to us or seek our input. In a letter written in response, caucus members reminded AIS leadership that, quote, many of us in the Queer Studies Caucus have decided or have had to find our paths outside of Italian studies because of or in conjunction with the pervasive experience of marginalization and conservatism within the field, unquote. Again, suggesting that interdisciplinary scholarship and not Italian studies per se has been a place where Italian queer work has been welcome. I want to talk now about something that I'm uneasy including in this paper. But, you know, as RuPaul says, we're all squirrel friends here. So please take this in the spirit of generosity and discussion that it's meant to provoke. Many of you recently received via listserv an announcement of the upcoming Brown Harvard Graduate Student Conference, Queering Italian Studies, Pensieri e Pratiche Italiane di Sovversione Culturale. What is striking to me in the call for papers is its lack of recognition of existing work. The call, for example, quote, aims to suggest directions for queering Italian studies, unquote, as if such an effort is not already underway. The call continues, quote, we wish to stimulate a debate that in Italy remains outside the institutional discourse, unquote. This news would presumably surprise the many intellectuals, activists, and artists who for some years now have been working in conjunction with the Centro di Ricerca Politesse, Politiche e Teorie della Sessualità of the University of Verona, as well as the Centro Interuniversitario di Ricerca Queer of the University of Pisa. Here's a part I'm really nervous about. It is also worth noting that the extremely fine keynote speakers chosen for the conference do not identify their own research interests as queer Italian studies and have not been active in the queer caucus of AAIS, for example. I am not suggesting here that their work could not be interpreted as in Italian queer studies. I am suggesting that choosing keynote speakers demonstrably and deservedly famous, who do not, however, identify as scholars of queer Italian studies, centers one body of work and risks pushing to the margins another, and that such gestures are not disciplinarily innocent. I'm not talking just about me, okay? I was afraid that people are gonna say, oh, he's got queer in the title of two of his books, he's the one he wanted to be the keynote speaker. But there are at least four people in the room here who could have been invited, who've been doing this work for a sustained amount of time. A recent experience in Italy highlighted for me that, again, the temporal complexities of engaging in research that identifies itself as Italian queer studies. I am at work on a book that includes a section on the painter Corrado Calli. Until recently, no one was willing to write frankly on his bisexuality. A recent book in Italian, however, broke that silence and was even brave enough to write of the critical dishonesty of continuing to ignore the sexuality of this painter whose work was sometimes, frankly, homoerotic. This is Raffaele Bedarida's recent book on Calli's years in America. It's a fantastic book, really highly documented. And what Raffaele says is there's this inverse relationship between the amount of gossip on Kali's sexual life and the actual writing on Kali's sexuality and its influence on his painting. So encouraged by Raffaele, I contacted the painter's archive about permission to publish images, which I had avoided doing. Before granting me permission, the archivists asked to read my manuscript. And I mentioned to them that a section of the book deals with, and I won't out him, but Kali's former assistant and lover, who is still alive and was literally at the time of our conversation sitting in the next room. The section of my manuscript in question was an interpretation of a photograph of the two of them in which I talked about the signs of intimacy that anyone willing to look could see. And one of the archivists pushed me to remove this section. And when I sort of hemmed and hawed, his response was something like, well, you know, he's Sicilian. And that was supposed to explain everything, right? To begin where I started, I don't want to overread this very local occurrence. Nonetheless, it represents a concrete instance of how heteronormative assumptions and concerns still interfere with the producing of knowledge of queer Italy. If any of you do work in art history, you know that almost nothing exists in English on Cagli, let alone the other two guys I'm writing on, De Pisis and Giovanni Camisso. Camisso is being forgotten in Italy right now, even as we speak. By allowing us to re-engage with his art, an exploration of a queer Cagli promises to provide a richer, fuller understanding of the history of interwar sexuality and Italy's contribution to the history of so-called modern sexuality. That such efforts remain over 50 years after Cagli's death, hindered by a widely normalized practice of don't ask, don't tell, suggests the work ahead of us. Thank you.
Our final paper of this session before we open up for questions is Ryan Calabretta-Sajder, AIDS in the Italian and Italian-American Canon, Death as Metaphor for a Profession in Peril.
Okay, thank you, Donna. Since the foundation of the Nobel, 51 women have been awarded this monumentous recognition. Marie Curie, the first woman to have been bestowed the award and the only female to date to have won it twice. Of the 51 prizes awarded to women at large, 14 Nobels have gone to women in literature, the second being Italy's Grazia Deledda in 1926, who is noted amongst the likes of Toni Morrison, Doris Lessing, and Nellie Sachs, to underscore a few. Significantly before Deledda enters the international stage, however, Italy has already been graced with the marvelous modern female authors like Maria Messina and Sabila Alaramo. Alaramo completed her semi-autobiographical novel, Una Donna, as early as 1901, but scholars claim that she contemplated the ending as to whether or not she should use her autobiographical end of her own story, finally publishing it in 1904 with the true ending, which was leaving her husband and son behind. Noted as one of the earliest feminist awakenings in the Western canon, bar none to Ibsen's Dollhouse, which is cited in the novel, Una Donna is a masterpiece in Italian literature. For the feminist canon, it is essential, yet almost unknown to the Anglophone world. But how can this be? While still a master's student, I was enrolled in a course on the Italian novel. Taught as a traditional chronological review of the canon, we studied only male authors. Not one female was ever mentioned throughout the semester, except when I gave my presentation on Una Donna. When the professor, who was an Italian male trained in Italy, was not glancing at the newspaper during my talk, he rudely interrupted my presentation to attempt to mansplain to my female colleague the nature of an awakening, following up on the comparison I made to Kate Chopin's stellar novel, The Awakening, 1899. At this point, he hurried the end of my presentation, and there were no other female authors addressed in my entire master's program. During my master's examination, there was not one question related to female writing, or even the representation of women within the canon, which, as we know, is not equivalent, but may be considered a half step in the right direction. This premise is to open a much larger discourse on the role of the canon in the future of our field. In his No Future, Lee Edelman states, quote, fuck the social order and the child in whose name we're collectively terrorized. Fuck Annie. Fuck the waif from Les Mis. Fuck the poor innocent kid of the net. Fuck laws, both with capital L's and with small. Fuck the whole network of symbolic relations and the future that serves as its prop, end quote. Edelman's unique citation draws attention, albeit in a bit of a grotesque manner, to the importance of the future and what we are collectively doing or not to preserve it for future generations. As already mentioned yesterday, Italian studies is falling short of successfully incorporating new life into a field, as Dennis Lunley has clearly demonstrated by the MLA report, and our future isn't bright. Edelman's book forces the reader to reconsider the role of the other in society and how the other is viewed, accepted. His wild metaphor of killing the child is just that, as he uses it on various levels. In this work, he fights to disrupt all efforts to produce a self-sufficient wholeness. Therefore, Edelman calls us to disrupt the past, break the cycle, and only then can we queer the future. Then I go into a little bit of past of Italian studies with women and the role of Teresa di Loretis. Skipping that, even though philology is still a dominant critical lens most Italian studies is analyzed, huge periods of Italian studies and numerous authors are consciously being ignored for students and scholars alike. Many female authors have been brushed over, pushed aside, considered not a worthy read, often due to their lack of formal training, which is only provided to men of the day. If research exists on these authors, it often does not represent the true sense of the text. Scholars are not applying the most appropriate critical lens to these works. Many are just as good as their male counterparts. Others may not, but this does not taint the importance of their work, particularly from a social, historical, political, and economic perspective. As scholars, but even more importantly as teachers, we need to incorporate these works into the classroom and offer them the appropriate attention they deserve. The 1990s opened doors to a richer, more well-thought-out approach to analyzing female literature. The Academy also began to welcome more women with PhDs into the field, which clearly changed the discussions of Italian studies greatly. Unfortunately, these discourses almost solely revolved around female scholars. Rarely do we encounter heterosexual male scholars plunging into the study of women. It is not surprising that one of the early ones actually organized this conference. Even though the 90s brought a newfound respect for female authors and the importance of a diverse authorship, these interests are not represented in the generation's PhD students. A grand concern still plagued a large portion of Italian studies regarding the then referenced women's studies and the ability to publish and find a job, as we heard earlier. In fact, the graduate faculty leading those programs tainted the field for a good two generations. Within the last 15 to 20 years, I dare say the field has begun to open up and much more attention has been given to female voices, even if huge blocks of space are still rather untouched, particularly Italian female poets and Italian women directors, which ironically within the Italian tradition dates back to Elvira Notari from Salerno, Italy, who made over 60 feature films and about 100 shorts and documentaries. Notari truly changed the film, how film was made and produced in Italy, and only one major project has been dedicated to her life's work, Streetwalking on a Ruined Map, Cultural Theory and the City of Film of Elvira Notari, published in 1992. So if we cannot get a grip on one of the most influential figures of Italian cinema, how can we pony up and invite diversity into our classroom? Moving beyond women, let's return to the concept of literature. Where are the female authors being taught? Although this version of my paper is still in draft form, I did attempt to conduct some quantitative research for today. I examined the PhD lists of almost all of the PhD grant institutions in North America, looking at their required texts in the realm of female and LGBTQI plus authors. The results were not all that surprising. I'm gonna kind of jump over. Basically, Una Donna was on most of the lists that actually have lists. In one list, it was optional. When we move the study, however, to examine the role of LGBTQI+, the situation becomes dismal. I particularly was interested in the role of Pier Vittorio Tondelli's Camere Separate, but was able to make various observations while studying these reading lists. Tondelli's Camere Separate only appeared on two lists. A third university required Altri Libertini, which is still better than excluding him completely. Many schools asked their students to prepare Aldo Palazzeschi's works, more often than not Il Codice di Perella, but one had Sorelle Matarassi, and even his poetry was mandatory for one or two schools. Although known as a homosexual author, noted in both his biography, but also clearly seen in his texts, particularly Il Codice, but also his poetry, noted literary critic Gino Tellini prefers to call him a celibate homosexual. Palazzeschi has been studied at length, and in fact, Tellini has organized numerous conferences on the beloved author over the years. Moreover, he has overseen Palazzeschi's archive, donated to the University of Florence, where he spent most of his career. However, the archive does not seem to serve the general populace. In fact, while I was on my Fulbright in the spring of 2017, I had plans to visit the archive, my ex-professor, overseas, but when I arrived in Florence, I was surprised to learn that I would not be granted access to the archive and that, quote, everything was online and I should access whatever I need there, end quote. I share this anecdote for various reasons. In Italian studies, scholars have continually modeled what I and some of my positive mentors have called bad behavior, which often is passed from professor to student. One of these bad behaviors is the concept that scholars own authors, periods, etc., and that junior colleagues must beg at the godfather's table to be able to study a particular writer. This situation revolving Palatsky has occurred to numerous scholars over the years, and the prejudice crosses the gender and sexuality lines. Tellini, who blocked me from studying queer theory in his own class on critical theory, knew that I would enter the archive and expose Palatsky as a homosexual author, a fact that everybody already knows. What he is unable to grasp is that by allowing me to enter the archive and access the text of such a rich author who struggled at length with his own sexual orientation, I would be opening an entire world to the field. Italian studies, however, prefers to run on power and fear rather than dialogue, collaboration, and forward thinking. Both Italian and Italian-American studies has a lot to offer cultural studies, yet too many of our senior scholars are blocked in the mindset of philology, which is important but has already been done. The field needs to be liberated to consider the wealth that it already has, but also to exchange new creative voices. The curriculum must shift, as we have most recently seen through the MLA report, that Italian has dipped drastically, and it was our only decrease in numbers historically, main decrease. Italian American studies boasts the first AIDS novel in the US canon. Although it was not the actual first novel to discuss AIDS, it has been granted the title. Robert Ferro, an Italian American, who was part of the famous Violet Quill writing group here in New York City, penned five novels, The Last Second Son, which was published in 1988, only months after Ferro's death from AIDS complications. The story recounts a son, Mark Valerian, attempting to get over his mother's recent death at the family's beach house, the house where she physically passes. Mark, who is suffering from an incurable disease, which is unnamed and only referred to as it throughout the text, is understood to be AIDS. Mark is set up with Bill, who is also infected with it, and the two deal with the frustrations associated with AIDS in the late 80s. In the end, Mark and Bill are faced with a choice to try an experimental drug to help them or to go to the planet Splendora, where there is a colony and folks infected with it. Although the novel sounds rather bleak, when published, it was described and reviewed as a novel of hope. I'm going to skip the part on Camere Separate because most of you are Italianists. But I'm going to go back to the concept of these texts, for example, would easily fit into any course on the novel, on the evolution of the building's roman, illness or trauma theory, definitions of family, etc. In one of her articles, Rebecca West argues against teaching women's literature outside of the canon, because by doing that, we only create a secondary canon, thus recreating our own problems. It's time, therefore, to get creative. I once taught a successful course on the concept of love in the Italian tradition, beginning with the troubadours, through the Tre Coroni, the love of country in the 18th century, and on to the family with Natalia Ginzburg, and ended with lesbian love in Rosanna Campo. The course was successful not only because it became a survey course, but also because it touched something that was relatable to the students in many manifestations. Before concluding today, I would like to end with a few responsibilities that we all share. I would like to reiterate the point that Julia and Sole mentioned yesterday. When it comes to gender identity issues and discourse, it falls on our shoulders to create safe spaces for dialogue. And I do believe that beginning with preferred pronouns is an important place to start. A colleague of mine recently informed me that she has a transgender student in her class. At first, she was not sure if the student was in fact transgender or not, but her TA informed her of the student's preferred pronoun. Those situations can easily be diffused by addressing them early and head on, and not only for the instructor, but for the entire class. Leo Bersani, another theorist who has changed the way we study gender in the 1980s, argues for a queer culture that is in fact queer and proud to be so. He pushed the gay culture to move away from the dichotomy and rather create a new language and culture that more perfectly defines it. In this vein, students want to read about situations familiar to themselves. Yes, we need to read some Dante, but we must also add some Amara Lacus and Dario Balletta to the curriculum. As teachers, we must attempt to introduce students to the multifaceted aspects of the culture, including non-normative, whatever that means, realities. Continuing with Bersani's theory present is the rectum of grave, our theorist pushes the status quo of those identifying as queer to act queer. Although there is not time nor space to delve into Bersani's conceptualization of the other, I would like to return to something they mentioned also yesterday during their talk, Julia and Sole. They claim that teaching off the beaten path those non-canonical texts is activism. As I have stated in past presentations on Queer in Italy, I do not share that same belief. In fact, as professors, I believe that is our responsibility to present these other perspectives of Italy. One of the issues of the current state of the humanities, it seems, is that professors no longer probably due to added service, research, teaching requirements, part of the political climate, also because many of us are have been or are in precarious situations, have a civic sense. We cannot expect our students to learn this on their own. We know that modeling is key. Therefore, to conclude, I do not buy the general belief that sexuality should not be brought into the classroom. I know that I will receive pushback on this from both heterosexual and queer colleagues. I also do fully understand that the coming out process is unique, and each person must confront that on his, her, their own terms. It is not easy. Yet there are plenty of us who are already out, yet you wouldn't know that they are. I do not teach in a major metropolitan city, rather Fayetteville, Arkansas, and teach not only Italian courses cross-listed in gender studies, but also courses in the PhD in comparative literature for the gender studies program, queer theories, the representation of AIDS through the arts, media, and literature, and queers on screen. Through these courses, I am able to cross-pollinate. I can bring my Italian minors into the realm of gender studies, but also bring these texts, Second Son and Camere Separate, into the queer classroom. I can attest that being out helps to create an environment of inclusion, particularly in courses cross-listed with gender studies. Although gender and sexuality are fluid concepts, always in flux, and one story is always unique, the old wives' tale still holds true. There is strength in numbers, strength, but also comfort. To return to Edelman's conceptualization, we need to kill off the child, but we also need to kill off the Lacanian fathers. We must queer the Italian curriculum, from questioning or leaving behind the canon, to pushing courses like Made in Italy, internships, Italy through pop culture, i.e. music and even street art, or commercial Italian, grounding the importance of Italian across the university. Remember, the engineering and business professors do not need us, unfortunately. We need them. More so, we must offer students a representation of their own makeup, i.e. queering it. We need to add LGBTQI+ writers to the curriculum, Sandro Pena, Dario Balezza, Rosanna Campo, Aldo Busi, and many more. If we do not start taking ownership of the curriculum and begin tailoring it to the 21st century, our future will be bleak. So, we are posed with a similar decision from Second Son. Do we take the safe road, trying the experimental drug for those affected with AIDS, or do we take the risk and journey to the planet Splendora, not certain of the risks, but relying solely on the rumor of its benefits? Thank you.
Thank you so much. I guess it's a question that goes to all four of you, because two of the talks, in a way, are especially Kenise. You deal with visible difference, and John and Ryan, you were looking at, you know, something that's invisible and can be hidden by choice. So kind of those two categories and how we kind of navigate those two, perhaps, and what are the maybe strategies or the differences you see between those two types of diversity. I know it's very open, but just thoughts on that.
I'll just say, I have never been able to hide my queerness, at least as of age 5. So I would dispute that.
When you treat students like people, you don't have to worry about it, I think is what it means, what I'm trying to say. So in one of my manifestations after I left the academy, I taught high school for 2 years. And my high school students taught me a whole lot. And one was to let them tell you who they are. And you make accommodations as necessary. I think I work in diversity work because I want people to see me. And I could care less if they have certain kind of attitudes about what they think my experience is, et cetera, et cetera. That's their personal opinion. What I'd like them to do is leave that outside, check it at the door, and understand that I am there to get what I need and to allow me the capacity to do that. I think it's just let your kids tell you, or your students, I'm sorry, I work with teenagers. Let them tell you who they are, and you go from there. You know, My grandmother has so many sayings that I love and are quite common, but you know, when you assume, you make an ass out of you and me. So don't make them.
I don't think it's an issue anymore with the students. I mean, I recently gave a
seminar on Made in Italy, and I was worried about including the unit that I do with my students, right, on Barilla being anti-gay and whatever, and that's with all these high school teachers from New York and New Jersey, and maybe it's also, you know, where we're at, but they were all like, oh no, we talk about this kind of stuff all the time in the classroom, you know, et cetera, et cetera. But I will tell you, I was on a job interview, and it was this is a very long story, but I'm gonna make it quite short. My gender identity came up more than once, and I had every right to sue. And one moment, the person took me out for a beer after the end of the day, and I was leaving, and he said, you have my vote. And I said, what? And he said, you have my vote. I'm voting for you for the job. And I said, I'm the first candidate of three. I know that. You can't tell me these things. And he said, no, I have you have my vote. I fought to bring you here on campus anyway, because it was obvious that you were gay by your CV. Okay, so it's not, I mean, yes, you can hide it, but someone who actually, when we work in the field, they understand that right away from our CV. They assume right away from the CV. And he said, our department is not diverse enough, and that's how I fought to bring you on campus. And I said, rewind, during my job talk, I was asked about how I get away with teaching so many gender studies classes. And in a moment of not filtering, I totally was like, I give them this whole great rationale on how I do it and how it's a program building strategy and, you know, how this has built programs in the past place I've been. And I said, I've been out since 22, since my first job, and I've taught in Italy and in the United States, north, south, east, and west, private, public schools, and I've never had a problem, and I don't envision having a problem here. So I told this guy, I said, you know, well, I'm not gonna get the job because I came out, you know, to your colleagues, they recorded it also, and they're like, oh no, now I can use that because now it's actually public knowledge. By the way, I didn't get the job.
I realized yesterday when Dennis was sharing with us the MLA findings of minority faculty that are hired for Italian studies that I did not show up because my name make me invisible. And so in your question, how visible you are. And so until they see me and they start guessing or thinking or putting together research and maybe the appearance, they don't know who I am, because my Italian name is disguising that. It's making me invisible. But I noticed that, on the other hand, that in terms of recruiting student, that was super powerful, that I could play in two different fields. And so every time that I used, just like Deborah said, the identity politics, and I said, you can become like me, because if I made it through, I came from Africa, if I made it through and I can speak Italian, you can do it. So it is so powerful. But at the same time, I can disguise in a different way. So I don't know if it is positive or negative, but I used for two purposes.
Kenise, do you think if you had gone to a different school, maybe a public university of some kind, it would have made a difference to how they responded to you? You were in a private Ivy League school. Would that have made a difference?
No.
No?
Okay. Hi, I enjoyed all the presentations. I wrote some stuff down so I wouldn't forget. But John, I don't think you should be worried about what you want to put in your paper. I know what you're saying, but I think those things need to be said. You know, that's why we're here today. I just wanted to give you a couple anecdotes myself. When I was proposing my PhD paper as well, I wanted to talk about the other and women in theater specifically with a couple of playwrights in particular. And I was told, like so many of you, by my male, white, older professor, that the other was now passé, basically saying that, like, it had been taken care of. Like, the problem is, just like you were saying, like, you guys were saying, when there's a little blip in something, people think it's done, it's been done enough. You know, we talked about it a little bit, and I said, you know, I want to work on Emilia Rosselli. Everybody says, yeah, the poet. I said, no. Emilia Pinkerle Rosselli, her grandmother, who wrote 7 plays, 3 in the Venetian dialect. Most people don't have any idea who she is. Because like Ryan said, so much of what's out there is passed over. So the fact that like people are working in queer studies and people are working in women's studies, I don't feel like it's ever gonna be enough, because we have almost 2,000 years of history to make up for. There's actually you were saying you were going to the archives in Florence. And in Florence, outside of Florence, in Calazzano, there's actually an archive for women in theater. But they do not hold anything that's from before 1950. So there's tons of work on that. And I took a class also by another of the same group of professors. And he taught a medieval and Renaissance theater class and never mentioned a single female playwright. They exist, I promise you that, in the church. And we also have Isabella Adriani and people like this. So that kind of stuff is really frustrating to me. And this idea that once it's sort of talked about, it's done and over with and we've done enough. And I fear like this is so great. And I really hope that someday it's not like, oh, okay, we've talked about Chinese-American relations enough and we've done enough with that literature and now we can move on to something else. And I think it's our job to sort of keep all that stuff alive. And I do feel like, as everybody's been talking, for me, it boils down to one point, and it's sort of, if we want to see the change in our students, in our curriculum, all those kinds of things, we have to invite more people of diverse backgrounds into the fold, okay? And because like we've all been saying that, like it's all been, most of us had male, white, older professors who came from Italy. And so I think it's so awesome to see many other people here today who are different and doing that, because we want to see teachers who are like this. But my point, sorry, at the risk of creating a second canon, a secondary canon, I really would like to see some sort of list, webpage, project, something where we all are sort of contributing our ideas of things that should be read. I after last night and today, I already have a list that's like 20 books long of things I feel like I need to read. So I don't know what you would, Ryan, what you would actually think about that, because I know we don't like the idea of the canon. I agree, but I think in some extent it might be nice to have some kind of,
unfortunately, we're
to
forced that way, right? Because if we don't teach those classes, those texts are just not taught at all. So I think the way though to do it is, if we rethink the curriculum, right? And I know French has been very good at this, and I don't know about other languages, but even at the undergraduate level, people are doing away with these survey courses and are instead taking thematic approaches to topics, right? And you can do that, like I mentioned, you know, the course on love and the Italian canon. You can do it starting with the medieval and going all the way through and still treating it as a survey, but, you know, formulating it very differently. So I think that's a way of sidestepping the secondary canon.
Let me just interject. Some of us had white, older male professors from Kansas.
I'm very grateful for this powerful and sobering critique of our discipline. Very, very grateful. And I have a question for you, and I'm going to frame the question. I work for Wheaton College in Massachusetts, which is, I would say, a pretty liberal place with a very strong commitment to diversity. And my work in women and gender studies and queer studies, post-colonial and migrant teaching has been very welcome there. And I have been working in this way for decades, right? But I have a particular problem now in the current political and media climate. And that is that, and I've been thinking about this since the very first panel yesterday. That is, in the moment in which I express my pronouns and ask students about their pronouns, or in the moment in which I discuss social justice, I am clearly politically positioning myself. And I have students who are conservative, whose voices are a little louder than they were 2 years ago, that are sometimes alienated. Students who I have a great deal of respect for and who may have a sort of a wide spectrum of political beliefs. And I just wonder, I think I'm not alone in this. I mean, I think Wheaton tends to be very more liberal, but I know that not all of us teach in this kind of institution. I wonder if anyone has advice on how to negotiate that. Because I believe that both the politicians and the media, in creating these echo chambers, have polarized us. And the students are particularly always on social media, always online, and are very polarized. When Trump was elected, it was a very difficult moment on our campus.
So I live 10 minutes outside of Washington, D.C. And I, for a living, have critical, difficult conversations with students. I actually facilitate workshops on these issues. And for some reason, I decided to teach a class of Italian at Catholic University this semester, just because I wanted extra money. I'm still precarious. I'm still highly underemployed. I've cobbled together a list of projects I deeply believe in, but they don't all pay me. So I am going into the classroom, and it's Catholic University of America. Predominantly ethnic white population, predominantly conservative Catholic. When the Pope came, they protested him. Poor Papa Francesco. And in another area, I work in the first public school in the United States for black folks after the Civil War, called Dunbar High School. And at Dunbar, I am empowering underserved students to negotiate the difficulties of being a young person of color and trying to live without a whole lot of resources, a good life. And there are lots of things that they kind of clap to, right? And I use a lot of slang now, so you'll have to excuse me. My scholarly register is gone. And I'm appreciative of it, actually. And so when I go into Catholic, I know I have to be mindful that there is people who disagree with me. That's fine. But I find it very empowering to use the guidelines that I use with my high schoolers, which is when you come into the classroom, there are five things that we use to guide. The first is one mic, only one person at a time, and you're actively listening. The second is safe space, which also kind of goes into brave space, right? So yes, we want everyone to be comfortable, but we also know that there needs to be some discomfort. There's also, if someone disagrees with you, they're not a bad person. So if you're a conservative, you know, there's a March for Life. School is not in session today because they're all going to protest abortion. And I had to talk about that. I'm pro-life. But it's, you have your opinion, and you are not going to be judged for your opinion, even if I disagree with you. And what my job is for you to understand how to hold that opinion in a way that's informed, and in a way that allows for other people to hold their own. The third is participation, so no one can opt out. And if you do opt out, you have to have a good reason after trying. And the fourth is people for technology. So yes, you can use your social media, and I think it's important to have conversations informed by social media, but also you need to understand what you're seeing, and we can have that in the conversation as well. And then the last is global awareness. And so when I walk into the Catholic classroom, with all of those things in mind, I'm able to talk with students who, when I ask, you know, in addition to being an American citizen, do you see yourself as a global citizen? Some say, yes, actually, I have Italian citizenship and American citizenship. Or they say, no, One kid said to me, well, I'm an American and America comes first, and so I can't be a global citizen. I don't know how to be loyal to America and a global citizen. And I said, that's fair. So I say all of that to say that you have to shape the conversation, and there are books and workshops that help with that. I think diversity and inclusion work is old. My mother has been doing this for 30 years in the field of engineering. Italian studies is not recreating the wheel. What you do is you go and you see what other disciplines have done, because they actually do it very well.
Hey, it would be weird for me not to say anything. I have 3 points and an impossible question, so good luck to you. Ryan, obviously you called me out for arguing that this is activism, what we're doing. And I think that even though we all might be on the same page, we are fighting against things, right? As John said, when S.A. Smythe and I founded the Queer Studies Caucus, we were graduate students, we were not allowed to be there, and we did it anyway. That's a good fight. Sorry, I'm very excited. The problem is precarity, right? We fought, I have been paying every year, nobody gives me money to go to ICE, nobody gives us anything to do the things that we're doing, we don't have access to resources, which is what makes the Queer Studies Caucus an impossible feat to sustain, right? I think what people don't understand is that not only is it impossible, but it also isn't just about sexuality or gender identity. Queer studies, we talked a lot about interdisciplinarity and cross-cultural communication, et cetera, et cetera. All of that is queering the field. We are all actively queering the discipline in some way. So to pretend that we're not all part of the queer conversation is not doing the queer conversation justice. But at the same time, there's the people who are getting visibility and privilege, as John, you were saying, are the cis straight allies doing the work because people feel safer inviting them into the space, right? So those are not the people attending the caucus. Those are not the people participating in our conversation. I want to invite you all to participate in that conversation. But I think, like, what do we do? What do we do now, right? The Queer Studies Caucus has canceled all its panels for this year's ICE because I can't afford it, and we're tired of fighting, and we are marginalized, and you're here, and you're over there, and you're over there, and it is pulling teeth to get us all to have the same conversation. So when Brown does a conference like that and has no idea what's going on, it's because we're fighting and we're not being seen anyway. So this is the question I ask myself, and I say, and I have conversations, and Soleil is also an organizing member, and we ask ourselves every year, what now? Whose teeth do we pull? How do we get more visible? What can we do? So you're on the panel, I put you on the spot. What can we do? There's your impossible question.
Just to clarify first, my point was just that, you know, teaching alone is not activism. What you have done is very different. I don't agree with that. But anyway, but I think teaching is the first step, right? But we do have to have a larger voice. We have to organize, you know, we have to support, you know, the precarious colleagues, period, across the field, and not just these and those. We need to, you know, have a more concerned effort. We need to organize more workshops and things, and you know, the colleagues who worked on the caucus actually did a marvelous job both here in Italy and in Inglaterra and England. So, you know, they have very much understand that concept. You know, going back to the whole Edelman kind of concept, we need, it's time to kill the fathers and start this new future. And I think it also starts in graduate school, right? I mean, those colleagues who did the caucus were not necessarily informed by any kind of school of thought. They took it upon themselves to organize and get things going. And that's an issue in our field. We need to move beyond that. You know, hopefully this is the first step. The volume hopefully will be a second step, but we need more attention in that direction, and I totally agree. And it starts with teaching. I don't think it's activism, but it does start with teaching because then we're training the next generation to think differently.
One of the difficulties that we face that's unique is that we don't know why we aren't being invited to certain things. You know what I mean? To speak very personally, I've made it past the Fulbright people twice, the Italian studies people in the US, and been denied twice by the Italians. Does that have to do with my vita, or is that something else? I got invited to do a keynote at a Toronto graduate student conference, and then that invitation was taken back. And I was told it was for monetary reasons. So obviously they thought someone else was worth paying and not me. But you know, you never know, right? And you and yet it fosters this feeling of paranoia, right? Right? And it, you know, as you're always reminding us, we live in these bodies. What I think has to happen is that those of you in high places need to start opening your mouths up, need to start inviting us to speak instead of the keynote, you know, maybe you want to hear so-and-so for the 10th time do a keynote. You know, take a risk on one of us.
But let me just say that there are about 84, 85 professors of Italian within a 35-mile radius of where we are. And there are three of us in this room, I think. Within 35 miles. You're too far. You don't count. No, Elisabetta's number four. So there are about four or five of us in this room. So to your point, we do need to invite them.
Good afternoon. Thanks for sharing your experiences. Antidotes like that are important to really go over for other people to know what some other people go through. First, I have a comment, then I have a general broad question. For the first speaker, are you familiar with Mark Fisher's book, Capitalist Realism? It talks about nostalgia. It basically expands on Derrida's argument of ontology and how the past continues to haunt us in the present because we cannot imagine a future. And Fisher ties that with capitalism, so it might be interesting for your work. And then the second general question is, I'm in American studies, so I'm kind of ignorant. I'm coming from a position of ignorance when I ask this question, but if we want to queer Italian studies and make it intersectional, who should we be reading, who should we be checking out? Even though some of you said you don't like the canon, but just a general question for someone like me who's coming from the other side of the Atlantic, who should I look at?
John?
I would say any male Italian author can be queered. And I mean, seriously, one of the really interesting things about this project for me is that the number of interwar male artists who had sex with other men, however they define themselves, is gigantic. The list that you could produce, even from the front, you know, like Pavese, if you wanted to talk about Pavese, but a lot of figures who are really disappearing from cultural memory, Guglielmo Yani, Saba, of course.
Yeah, you have a lot of poets. I mean, you have this whole experience of poetry from Pasolini to the present, and they all knew each other and commented on each other's work. So you have Dario Balezza, Sandro Penna. I think that's all very important. Italian cinema is starting to be queered a little bit. Fedezza Ospitek, who I work a lot on, but some of the female directors also. So there are those possibilities. And in Italian American, definitely Robert Ferro, Felice Piccano. Those are two really important. Peter Covino. Was a really wonderful poet too.
John Champagne.
John Champagne wrote a very, very early AIDS novel in 87. It was published. It's 87, according to my article.
I wrote it at Hunter.